These days, men are just as concerned with fashion as women, so it should come therefore as no surprise that when I made a video the other day talking about the best and worst female costumes in the MCU and DCEU, you guys demanded that I make a version for the guys, and so I have. However, as we discussed in the comment section over on that video, one of the obstacles to making such a video is that there are just so many more male characters than female characters. There are 12 major female characters in my video. I forgot Feyora. However, a lot more with guys, so I changed it up a little bit. For this episode, what I've done is I've decided to highlight the worst 5 male costumes in the MCU and the DCEU, and the best 5 male costumes in the MCU and DCEU. And Batman, by the way, is such a fashion plate, he's on here twice. Now, once again, here is my criteria for putting these two lists together. Number one, I take into account the original comic book costume. Number two, I also take into account how it's plussed for this new medium, for movies. And by that I mean raising the excitement factor, like, damn, he looks good, or in the other case, she. Or also real-world believability, because, you know, you're trying to reach a new audience and you don't want it to seem stupid to that audience. Because so often they dismiss our beloved comics as stupid, and the whole point of these movies is to prove that they're not. Although, it doesn't really work because nobody goes back and reads comics, unfortunately. Ah, so upsetting. But anyway, and then number three, it looks like an A movie, not a B movie. You know, we're trying to go high caliber here, so we don't want anything that looks cheesy. You know, like when comic book movies were not as popular because the mainstream audiences said they look stupid. And then finally, personal appeal, as in either you want to wear it or you want to sleep with the person who's wearing it. All right, so actually, I have to say, making this list, I have in my notes here, it was a little easier than I expected because a couple of characters counted themselves out because they were just dressed in what I like to call Marvel generic. That's Hawkeye, for instance, Falcon, right? It's all a variation on the same type of costume. I guess that's what S.H.I.E.L.D. was working with, right? And I think to some degree, to be fair, Black Widow is in that same category, although she ranked rather high on my list. But I think it's because it's so unusual to see a woman in that kind of a costume, right? I mean, Maria Hill didn't get it, right? All right, so we're going to start out with the worst first, and then we're going to go into the best, okay? So we're going to work our way up to number one. And again, this is like this is the list you don't want to be on. So number five, I'm sorry to say, is Doctor Strange, because less is more, dude. I think this costume is just way too ornate. I think that it looks too heavy, for instance. I don't know how he's going to move in that. And I think that it doesn't fit also with the MCU. There's just something about it to me that it's like torn between wanting to be authentic to the idea of this sorcerer, mystic person trained in the East, the Far East, albeit also being like, oh, I'm in a comic book movie. Like, for instance, I think a good example of this are the boots, right? Like, you guys, he's got these like punk rock boots on, but then for some reason he's like, to make it mystical, I'm gonna tie a bunch of straps around it, right? It's just too much. And also, I feel with no real purpose. I don't see any reason for him to be like, I'm gonna tie a blue strap all the way around my boot, except to maybe hide the fact that it's a modern day boot. I'm not quite sure. Now, to be fair, they weren't working with a very strong costume to begin with. I think the Doctor Strange costume is extremely hard to adapt to a mainstream audience. And I think that I would have rather they stuck with being more authentic to the character than trying to find, again, this middle ground, having their cake and eat it too, of having it fit with the MCU. Because those boots to me are a little bit like Marvel generic, again, creeping in there. Now, there are elements to this costume that we haven't really seen yet because we're waiting to see the film. Now, for instance, his cloak of levitation, which is now alive, could end up being really cool. Although I feel the patchworkness on the back of it is an odd choice. I'd be like, what happened to your cape? It's alive. Did someone torture it and cut it up like that? And then also, he's big pimping with that Infinity Stone around his neck, you know, like a hardcore rapper. He's got the bling. But, you know, then again, that looks weird next to the copious amounts of belts that he's tied around his waist. He's, like, super over-accessorized. Tim Gunn would be like, take some of that off. All right, so number five, again, Doctor Strange. And I encourage you to make your own lists down below because some of you may or may not agree with me. All right, so number four, I gotta go with Aquaman. And it pains me to do this, because I liked the original Aquaman costume that was presented to us, right? They did the old switcheroo. I'm not quite sure what happened to this amazing tattoo-based costume, which is spectacular, and how we went from this to him looking like a Shakespearean reject in the costume that we're now seeing for Justice League. Not only is it what we've seen in this poster, this Comic-Con artwork, but we've also seen it in the behind-the-scenes footage for the Justice League movie. Maybe it's too cold where they're going, and he's like, this is like Aquaman's version of like his jacket, right? But some of you have said, well, and I have similar problems with the Mira costume, right? This looks like an underwater look. For instance, if you were to look at a Shakespearean actor, you'd be like, dude, go in the pool. You'd be like, take that off, right? Some of you have said, well, it's because there's so much pressure underwater that that's why they wear this armor. And to that I would say, I've been thinking about it, my rebuttal is, well, then what about their faces? Aren't their faces going to implode when they go that deep? If that's the case, they should have full body costumes that cover them entirely, like Ant-Man, right? Someone was a real Ant-Man costume fan. Ant-Man did not make my list in any place, but I respected that person's love for the Ant-Man costume. I hope they'll chime in down below as to why they like it so much. But anyway, back to Aquaman. Furthermore, a lot of us were really excited with the idea of casting a Pacific Islander type person in this role, because it's a different way to look at the people of the sea, right? And so Jason Momoa is an interesting direction to take the character in. And that's what I like so much about the first costume, the first variation that we saw, that it looked very much like something that a Pacific Islander would wear. Jason Momoa himself hails from Hawaii. But I have to say, I looked it up, and in all the history of Pacific Islanders, no one wears armor, right? And they had some pretty fierce warriors, but they dressed more like this version of Aquaman than this version of Aquaman. Plus, I mean, look at the cool factor. There's this one photo of him during, this photo shoot when they took it originally, and he just looks so cool. He's like the male model Aquaman. Nobody would make fun of that guy. So I don't know why you would have that and then be like, you know what? Let's put a jacket on him, right? And not even like a cool jacket, like that kind of like a Talbot's for Men jacket, right? Like the one that your parents give you and they're like, you can borrow my jacket. And you're like, no, I really don't want to borrow your jacket. I'd rather get sick than be seen in that. All right. So number three, worst male costume in the MCU and the DCEU is Cyborg. I feel so bad. He hasn't even debuted yet. But something that's always bothered me about Cyborg is that, you know, he's supposed to represent. There's a lot of diversity in the people who read comic books, but not so much in the comic book characters themselves. So that's one of the reasons that Cyborg got the call up to the Justice League from the Titans or Teen Titans, whatever they're called at the moment, because they needed some diversity badly, right? That's why sometimes Vixen also gets the call, but not to the same degree. But I've always felt bad because I was like, you know, Cyborg, I don't think anyone wants to dress up as Cyborg, right? Like, I see a very few people being like, dude, I'll be Cyborg. They're like, no, I'm going to do some race bending for Batman or Superman, or I'm going to, you know, go to other characters from largely Marvel. I believe, you know, there's like Black Lightning, Static Shock, those are a little bit better, diverse DC characters. But Cyborg, I'm really also surprised that they made him still so bulky. You know, poor Ray Fisher had to walk around set, as we saw from the behind-the-scenes footage, in a motion capture suit, a really unflattering lame one, right? So I don't understand why his costume looks like they just snapped pieces onto him still. I mean, I guess the pieces have to like move and do stuff, so that's why they're CGI. But I mean, if you have the guy in a CGI suit, he has no actual leg there, why do you have to build a full leg? Look at Saw Gerrera. Saw Gerrera doesn't have a full leg. He owns having a mechanical robot leg, you know? And I think, and also with even the Terminator movies, you know, when they weren't trying to pass for human, they worked it. So I'm really trying to work in some fashion terms here. So I'm just really surprised with this choice. Even in the comics, they eventually ended up slimming him down for the New 52. I'm not quite sure what he looks like at the moment, but I thought this was a better look because it looks more like something that a fan would actually want to wear. Whereas instead, Cyborg always looks like, man, you just have too much hardware on you, especially today when tech tries to slim down, right? Gone is the disk drive, right? Everything is Wi-Fi, everything's plugged in. And, you know, I'd be like, you know, Cyborg, you just got too much hardware on you. So I have a real problem with that. And I think that they could have really fixed that in the movie. So I'm disappointed in that. And that's why he's number three. All right, the second worst costume. Oh, we're getting down to the wire here. I gotta go with Vision. I love Vision, but I feel like there's such a missed opportunity here. And I have to, again, just like with Doctor Strange and a lot of these characters, what they were originally working with from the comics, not so great. And this really calls into question, like, a bigger question overall with costume design, is to when is it better to have the character look like they walked off the page, and when is it better to redefine them, to make people, maybe make people more excited about the character, right? I feel like, you know, Vince Vaughn in the pitch room, like, that's what you want to go with. Like, come on, baby, this is so much better. And I know a lot of you are really like, wow, it looks like it's just from the comics. But if the character was never that popular and they always looked a little silly, you know, I think there's nothing wrong with modernizing them and making them just a better character, right? So Vision, again, they're trying to be really faithful to the comics. And I think that's the reason he has a cape. And as I said, he had Thor envy, and that's exactly actually what ended up happening, which I thought was hilarious. Thank you to everybody who remembered that I called it first. But in reality, there's no reason that Vision would wear a cape. It doesn't make any sense. And I think that for all the CGI work they try and do, like you see them filming here as well, and they put some marks on his face for CGI work, I'd be like, you know, dude, at the end of the day, when I watched your movie, it just looked like you put paint on Paul Bettany's face and glued some appliques to his head. He doesn't look nearly as otherworldly and robotic as he could. Why doesn't he have, like, glowy eyes, right? Or just eyes, at least, that are all white? I mean, I guess they feel like it would be hard to relate to the character if he didn't have pupils. Like, that's the whole Cyclops problem that James Marsden has talked about. But come on, step up your acting game, Paul Bettany. It's a challenge. I just think I would prefer to look at Vision and be instantly aware that he was not human, right? He was a robot trying to be human. And I think they've done a very good job with achieving that in the current Vision comic, where Vision has built himself a whole family. And if you haven't seen the Vision comic, I mean, if you haven't read the Vision comic, you are really missing out. It is one of the best comic books on the stands today. So, and also I think that would really play into the romance that's probably coming, because they've already started to lay the groundwork of that with him and Scarlet Witch. Because right now it looks like she's just, you know, going to be dating a guy who has a weird robot fetish, right? Instead of making out with a robot, which is super creepy, but super interesting and fetishy. And I think a lot of people would be, you know, it's like, it's a movie. It's like, well, you can experiment with robots through Scarlet Witch. But they're not going to play up on that because it just looks like a guy in face paint. I mean, if you wanted to go as Vision for Halloween, you could easily achieve it because there's not much to the costume. Now, finally, you're going to be shocked about this. The worst costume I feel it currently exists in the MCU and the DCEU is the gray Batman suit. What? I know some of you are probably like, peace out, this is ridiculous. But hear me out. I'm not talking about how cool the suit looks in the warehouse fight sequence. I mean, look at this stunt double wearing the suit. It's amazing. But there are clearly two versions of the suit, one for the stunts and one for Ben Affleck to wear in the less athletic scenes and for publicity shots. And take a look at it here. How can you argue with me that that isn't the worst suit? I mean, this is dad bod Batman, right? It just looks absolutely horrible. Talk about practicality. I don't think it looks like he can move in it. I don't think it looks like he can turn his head in it. I don't think he can sit in it. It's just absolutely ridiculous. It looks like Alfred got super protective and just decided to wrap him in foam and paint it gray and be like, okay, good luck. Be careful out there. I mean, I just really have horrible problems with it. I think it looks really bad, and I'm glad that they're changing it at least part of the time for Justice League. I mean, I think that's one of the reasons that you don't see him wearing it very much in the Batman v Superman movie, because Ben Affleck looks so much better as Bruce Wayne. So I can understand what they were going for. They wanted the bulk of the Dark Knight Returns that Frank Miller drew, and they wanted to just have him seem like this massive force, but it didn't work. And I think that they know it didn't work, which is why, they've changed it for Justice League. So, again, I like the gray suit, and it's trying to pay an homage to the suit that we like so much in the comics and the animated series, but I think that, again, it just looks like he has, like, a puffer coat on. It looks like those little kids whose parents don't want them to get sick and make it, and they go play out in the snow if you can. It's like a horrible catch-22 of childhood. All right, so that's the worst costumes. Now let's move on to the best costumes, all right? We're going to end on a positive. All right, so next up, the fifth best costume right now in the MCU and the DCEU is Ezra Miller's Flash, because I think this has really captured people's imagination. I think that the Flash And it's hard because he had to overcome the very popular TV version of the character right now that exists on the CW. So I think they had to not only please that fandom, but make it not look like they were copying it. It had to seem very different. So I'm pretty impressed with what they've been able to accomplish there. I also think one of the weirdest things about this, and one of the most mesmerizing things about Ezra Miller's Flash costume, is that he fits into it, right? Like, Cyborg is the one wearing a CGI suit on set, yet Ezra Miller's actually wearing that. Like, where do his organs go? It's just so small and tiny. It's crazy. And I think that Ezra Miller has a pretty lanky body shape. I think Tim Burton would be like, did I draw you and you came to life? Are you my Pinocchio? But anyway, I think they use that to great effect in this costume. Also, lightning bolts, the light is very flattering and blows out some of the edges to make him appear even more stick figure-like. Now, speaking of the lightning, that's part of the costume. I think the choice to go blue rather than yellow, as they do in the comics, was to differentiate from the television show. And also Zack Snyder's color palette of choice. He's like, yellow, get that out of here. But I think also what else I like about the costume is that, you know, some people don't like the pieces, some people do. I like it because, you know, the idea that we've heard is that Barry Allen built this himself with a 3D printer. And it adds to the science can-do aspect of it. You know, it really kind of puts Barry Allen's personal stamp on the costume instead of him just wearing, you know, again, like a red and yellow cat, you know, cat suit or, you know, a stretchy suit, basically. And I think it adds a real strong element of science. So he's kind of like the science bro, the first science bro of the DCEU. So I really like this costume. I think it's great. And I think that you can't deny that it really seems to have captured people's attention. Also, finally, it comes with amazing time travel accessories. So cool. I love it. I also like his 5 o'clock shadow. I think he should consider adding that permanently to his costume in all the DCEU movies. What happens in the future? The Barry Allen stops shaving. Okay. All right. The fourth best costume is Black Panther. And this is partially amazing because of how far the costume has come. You know, it used to focus more on being an homage to African culture. A lot of gold jewelry, a little kind of baby cape. I don't know about the baby cape. I think that was always an odd choice. I've never seen a panther in a cape, have you? And maybe they're like, we have to make sure people don't think he's an actual panther. We have to, you know, distinguish it's a human. But I prefer this high-tech look much more. I think this is very representative of Wakanda today. It's got still the African motif, but it's very high-tech. I think that the silver, vibranium detail work is really awesome. It really makes it stand out. And I think it makes it seem more masculine, even though, again, it's a guy wearing a skin-tight catsuit. You know, and also, speaking of making things masculine, whoever would have guessed they could make claws manly? But they totally do. His claws are super masculine. So I'm very impressed with that. I just think also it's very striking. And this is another case where they were able to, this is a case where they were able to bulk character up, but I think it worked. He still seems to have a lot of mobility. I really like this costume. And this is something I think that people would want to wear. In direct contrast to Cyborg. Again, working to bring diversity to the lineup. But here I think this is something that people can be proud of. Whereas Cyborg, it's like, well, at least we got a piece on the board. So I like this costume quite a bit. It's really cool. I also like that his Wakandan themed music kicks in whenever he's on screen as well. And he's even got like the ninja toes. It's a lot of great detail work. I really like it quite a bit. And it seems very light, very lightweight, but also still very tech heavy. And interestingly enough, in the comic book that's out right now, he still is more in the body stocking camp instead of like, you know, kind of like some kind of tech weave. But I will say that the comic book, I don't know how they're able to do this because, you know, it still looks like a body stocking, but there are some more other technologically advanced portions of that costume. It has like repulsor rays, like almost like a concussion blast that it can emit. And it's got a cool mask that comes in and on like Iron Man's. And they didn't incorporate that yet into the movie version. But I really like this costume a lot. I think it's excellent. All right, number three, Jared Leto's Joker. I gotta go with Jared Leto's Joker. I think this might be one of my most controversial choices, but I have mad respect for this. It, you know, just with the tattoos, it was a little jarring. But as it came together over the course of the publicity campaign, and then we finally saw it in the movie, I think it really worked. And again, as I've theorized before, they introduced it so early so that we had time to get used to it. But I also will note that it was very hard for me to pick a Joker costume as the best one. And I think that speaks to the star power that Jared Leto has brought to the role. Also, the face aspects of it, shaving off the eyebrows, deciding not to go for a distorted mouth with scars or, you know, the weird stretchiness that Jack Nicholson had. It makes the character very sexy, but still very scary. You know, I think Jared Leto's really been able to turn the character into a heartthrob, but not lessen, you know, the impact of the character either. So I think that that's something that Jared Leto should be very proud of. Well, there are other things he's not so proud of when it came to how this turned out. But I went with this version of the character, with the purple trench coat. Sometimes he's got the bling, sometimes he doesn't, because I just think that it's the most like the Joker that we've seen in the past. Because the Joker, in the past, the Batman villains have been the mob equivalent, and David Ayer pulled it into gang territory, which makes sense. The mob is really a criminal institution of the past, at least when it comes to entertainment. Gangs have really stepped forward to be in the forefront of crime. So reimagining the Joker in that way, you know, this plays into Latino gang culture, the Russian mob, actually, you know, the current Russian mob. I think it's very, very smart. But it's even beyond the tattoos. I think this purple jacket is amazing. I think it's really fit. It's just a really great choice. I think it's the most like a callback to the older version of the character. And I absolutely love the Arkham sweatpants. I think that's just so great. I just think it, you know, it gives a scariness factor. It makes it, you're instantly aware that he's escaped from Arkham Asylum. I love the fact that he's like, yeah, that's my other home. It's my summer home. I think that's great. And I love him being barefoot. I think it really works. I think that while everybody's liked the Joker in the past as a very compelling character, and people wanted to be Heath Ledger too, to be fair. He had like a Dapper Dan kind of thing going on. But I think that Jared Leto finally took the character and made him as cool as being Batman, and that's really hard to do. I just absolutely love this. It's the best reinvention I've ever seen of a character to make him very, very modern and accessible to today's mainstream audience. Spectacular. Now, number two, the runner-up of the best costume in the MCU and the DCEU is Batman. Speaking of sexy, I think it's funny that he's not only gotten much leaner in this costume, as you can see, but he not only seems sexier, but I think with the choice of the goggles, it's like Batman decided to be sexier. Like, he knows it, right? Sexy, and I know it, right? I think that's just absolutely fantastic. But I mean, it makes sense. If you have a sexy Joker, why not a sexy Batman? And I think that this is also drawing strong influence. I think that the gray suit, while that drew influence from the comics and the animation, I think this comes directly from the video games, the very, very popular Batman Arkham video games. And I think even more so from that short, the Arkham Knight short, where he took on Deathstroke, who of course is joining the movies. I would not be surprised to know that that short was incredibly influential to Snyder and Affleck and the whole team as they move forward. So I think it's a great costume. I think it fixes all the problems that the Batman gray suit has. And I think, you know, I think that they were like, you know, Ben Affleck, he has a lot of bulk in the shoulders, but he's lean, you know, he's worked on getting that tiny little waist, so let's show it off, right? He's like, look how small my utility belt is. When the villains always take it, they'll be like, damn, this is so tiny, I have to put it over my shoulder. So it's great. And those goggles are such a striking choice. I think it's absolutely hilarious. I love the costume. I think it's good. I think it looks more like it has more like an armor aspect built into it. I think it's a really great choice, and it's a huge improvement over the gray suit. I hope he dons it for most of the movie. I did like the gray suit in the warehouse sequence with the stunt double, but I feel like it doesn't seem like it offers a lot of protection. All right, then finally, I think you can guess who the best costume is in the MCU and the DCEU. And that's Captain America. I think one of the reasons that it won was that it's had the most improvement, going from the absolute goofiest costume in comics to the coolest, right? I mean, look, the guy used to wear pirate boots, a crazy flag on his face with little wings on the side. I mean, Flash has things on the side too, but they're not little tiny wings. They're lightning bolts, which is cooler. But it was, and also they, to some degree, there's like, they serve a purpose, making it more aerodynamic. Why the heck does Cap have those on the side of his head? You know, and then they were able to take that costume and reimagine it in a really fantastic way that I think if you were to ask a real world soldier to put this on, they wouldn't be embarrassed. They'd be proud and feel very powerful in it. It's really impressive. Now, I have to say, I considered going with the Winter Soldier version of the costume, but I ultimately went with the one from Civil War because I thought that by removing the flag elements from the Winter Soldier costume, that really echoed Captain America second-guessing his patriotism if he really wanted to represent his country, etc. You know, the whole argument he was having with Nick Fury. And I realized at the end of Civil War, he dropped the shield, right? But up until that point, I think that we were dealing with a very confident Captain America who was very sure of himself and his choices, even when they were unpopular. And I think that's one of the things that makes him seem like such a strong leader, that he knows the path he thinks needs to be walked and he will not be undeterred. Some people might say that's a negative aspect, like Iron Man and myself, and what path he's walking and why. Those are discussions for another time. But I think that this costume very much shows the character's confidence in who he is and assuming the role of Captain America later, of course, to end up, walking away from it. But I really like the costume. And that's another big thing. He's able to incorporate the flag in a non-cheesy way. And I think that's also incredibly impressive. Now, the other great thing about this costume is the mask comes on and off for versatility. He has two different looks. And on that note, the haircut is also a big part of the costume. It's a really conservative cut, like someone from the 1940s would wear, but it still has like a very sexy, modern edge to it as well. It's a timeless cut, and we're going to get to timeless in just a second. But one other thing I want to point out is one of the best things about this costume is the mock turtleneck. Guys look really good in a mock turtleneck. It's like right up there with a great suit. So putting a mock turtleneck in here was a great way to go. I think it's one of the things when the costume looks best. And you'll notice that, he'll often wear a similar neckline when he's out of costume, right? And then I think that as far as Captain America goes in this costume, with the hair, I said it had a timeless quality to it. I think that the costume does too. I mean, this is Americana from Ralph Lauren to Abercrombie & Fitch. And it's really impressive. I just think it's an absolutely fantastic costume. And again, to go from what Captain America used to look like to this, that is just amazing. Even the way the shield attaches to the back and the way it there's like a magnet there that puts it, holds it in place. It's just a very dynamic costume. And with the shield, it comes with sound effects. It's a great, great costume. And I think the best costume that we have in the comic book movies to date. So those are my rankings. I'm very curious to hear yours down below. Remember, it's only for current MCU and DCEU movies. And in the DCEU, that's Man of Steel, Batman v Superman, and Suicide Squad. All right, so write your thoughts down below, and you can check out some more videos right now.